Well, welcome and good morning. We're so glad you're here to worship our glorious God and Savior on this beautiful Lord's Day. We're going to go ahead and open with Ecclesiastes 4, if you wouldn't mind standing for the word of God. Hear now the word of the living and true God. Then I looked up again at all the acts of oppression which were done under the sun, and behold, I saw the tears of the oppressed, and that they had no one to comfort them. And on the side of their oppressors was power, but they had no one to comfort them. So I lauded the dead who were already dead more than the living who are still living. But better off than both of them is the one who has never been, who has never seen the evil work that is done under the sun. I have seen every labor and every success of the work that is a result of jealousy between a man and his neighbor. This too is vanity and striving after wind. The fool folds his hands in embrace and consumes his own flesh. One hand full of rest is better than two fists full of labor and striving after wind. Then I looked again at the vanity under the sun. There was a certain man without a second man, having neither a son nor a brother, yet there was no end to all his labor. Indeed, his eyes were not satisfied with riches. And for whom am I laboring and depriving myself of good? This too is vanity, and it is a grievous endeavor. Two are better than one because they have good wages for their labor. For if either of them falls, one will lift up his companion. But woe to the one who falls, and there is not a second to lift him up. Furthermore, if two lie down together, they keep warm. How can one be warm alone? And if one can overpower him who is alone, two can stand against him. A cord of three strands is not quickly torn apart. A poor yet wise lad is better off than an old foolish king who no longer knows how to receive warning. For he has come out of prison to become king, even though he has been was born poor in his kingdom. I have seen all the living who walk under the sun go along with the second lad who stands in the place of him. There is no end to all the people, to all who were before them, and even the ones who will come later will not be glad with them, for this too is vanity and striving after wind. Glorious Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for your words of wisdom, for your words of caution, Lord, that you have laid out a right and righteous way for us to live. Lord, we pray that by your Spirit we may always walk in that path. Lord, that we may never harden our hearts against warning and discipline, Lord. We just strive to live for you, but we desire your will and correction on our lives when we walk away. I always pray that you would guide and direct in the service, that all the singing and reading and preaching would be glorifying to you and edifying to your people. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen. Well, it is an exciting morning, and welcome. It's Resurrection Sunday for us as we're in Matthew and finishing up. So that's exactly how we're going to sing this morning, that God is, Christ is risen, and he's risen indeed. So let's sing together.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him laid, Here in the death of Christ I live.
Amen. Woo.
There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power in hell nor scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Thank goodness. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand. No power of hell nor scheme of man can ever crush me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand.
Well, good morning. What a beautiful morning it is, and I want to welcome you all with us today. Our scripture reading is going to come out of the book of Mark 16, 1 through 13, so you can be prepared. Next Sunday is going to be our fellowship meal right after worship, so we always enjoy coming together and sharing a meal together, and so it's just a good time. So look forward to that. All right, let's take a moment of silence before God's word is read. And when the Sabbath passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so that they might come and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw the stone had been rolled away, although it was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, wearing a white robe, and were amazed. And he said to them, "Do not be amazed. You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who has been crucified. He has risen. He is not here. Behold, the place where they laid him. But go tell the disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you to Galilee, where you will see him, just as he told you." And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment were gripping them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Now, after he had risen early on the first day of the week, he first appeared to Mary Magdalene, from whom he had cast out seven demons. She went and reported to those who had been with him while they were mourning and crying, and they heard it that he was alive and had been seen by her. They refused to believe it. After that, he appeared in a different form to two of them while they were walking along on this way to the countryside. And they went away and reported it to the others, but they did not believe them either.
Come behold the wondrous mystery in the dawning of the King. He, the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In our longing, in our darkness, now the light of light has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Come behold the wondrous mystery, he the perfect Son of Man. In his living, in his suffering, ne'er a trace nor stain of sin. See the true and better Adam come to save the hell-bound man. Christ the great and sure fulfillment of the law, in him we stand. Come behold the wondrous mystery, Christ the Lord upon the tree. In the stead of ruined sinners hangs the Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption, see the Father's plan unfold. Bring the many sons of glory, grace unmeasured, love untold. Come behold the wondrous mystery, slain by death the God of life. But no grave could e'er restrain him. Praise the Lord, he is alive. A foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering our hope. Christ in power resurrected, as we will be when he comes. Foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering our hope. Christ in power resurrected, as we will be when he comes.
Wow, what a day. Woo. I'm ready for him to come.
We bow our hearts, we lift our hands, we turn our eyes to you again, and we surrender to the truth that all we need is found in you. Receive our adoration, Jesus, Lamb of God. Receive our adoration, how wonderful you are. We choose to leave it all behind and turn our eyes towards the prize, the upward call, God in Christ. Open our hearts, Lord, take our lives. Receive our adoration, Jesus, Lamb of God. Receive our adoration, how wonderful you are. Every glory you've saved, everything you made resounds. All creation standing now, lifting up your name. We're joining in the angels' song. We're gathered to your ancient throne, children of our Father's arms, shouting out your praise. Receive adoration, Jesus, Lamb of God. Receive our adoration, how wonderful you are. Receive our adoration, Jesus, Lamb of God. Receive our adoration, how wonderful you are.
Gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom.
That's true.
My steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
No boasting. All through Him.
The night is dark, but I am not forsaken. For by my side, the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need, His power is displayed. To this I hold, my Shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but Christ in me. Fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave.
Amen. Woo.
To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released,
I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Every breath
I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home, and day by day I know he will renew me until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, till my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Out, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes, amen. And hallelujah. Woo. Resurrection Sunday. We celebrate the resurrection every day of the week. Amen. It is a beautiful day in the house of the Lord. It's been good to already fellowship with you and worship our great God and our Lord and Savior through music. And today I want to just say again, good morning. Our message today, you'll see it in your bulletin, is the Messiah's triumphant resurrection. And if you can stand, which you already are, for the reading of the Word of God, let us pray and seek God's face as we look into one of the greatest days in the history of this world, resurrection, nearly 2,000 years ago. Father, you have been found faithful again. And Father, we're here, your people, drawn to the cross of your Son, Jesus Christ, by the effectual call. Father, we stand justified because of his blood, because of the atoning blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, thank you. Lord Jesus, thank you. Blessed Holy Spirit, thank you. We rejoice in knowing that one day we will walk into your presence because of our resurrected Lord and his call upon our lives. Father, thank you now. Be with us now. Help us as we listen into the story that we're familiar with, and may we continue to rejoice in the work that you did at that wonderful day, Lord. And we just praise you now and thank you, give you all the glory and all the praise. We just ask now that you would receive our worship. Father, we also ask now, blessed Holy Spirit, and come now and illuminate your word to us, teach us. Father, remind us. Help us to have a renewed love for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And in his precious name we pray. Amen. Well, we're in Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 15. And now after the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave. And behold, there was a great earthquake. For an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled the stone and sat upon it. And his appearance was like lightning and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards quaked from fear of him and became like dead men. And the angel answered and said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified. He is not here, for he is risen." Amen. And all God's people say, "He has been. He is risen indeed, hasn't he? He is not here, for he is risen. Just as he said, come see the place where he was lying. And so, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. And there you will see him. And behold, I have told you." And they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to report to his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings, shalom." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. And then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and report to my brothers to leave for Galilee, and there they will see me." Now while they were on their way, behold, some of the guard came into the city and reported to the chief priest all that had happened. And when they had assembled with the elders and took counsel together, they gave a large sum of money to the soldiers and said, "You are to say his disciples came by night and stole him away while we were asleep. And if this is heard before the governor, we will win him over and keep you out of trouble." And they took the money and did as they had been instructed. And this story was widely spread among the Jews and is to this day. Well, you may be seated as we look into this wonderful event. The last time that we were together, we were introduced to one of the beloved Christians at the death of Christ, and that was Joseph of Arimathea. You'll remember that, who was a disciple. He was a secret disciple, but no longer a secret disciple. He was a disciple of Jesus Christ. And we heard the religious leaders' request before Pilate, "Therefore, order for the grave to be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples come and steal him away and say to the people, he has risen from the dead, and the last deception will be worse than the first." And that's where we left off last time together. They're already planning their evil deeds. Well, today, the significance of the resurrection of Jesus Christ is that it radically changed the history of the world as we know it. It validated all of Christ's claims. It constituted the greatest proof of his deity. Amen? Every single prophecy. And Paul says in Romans 1, 3 through 4, concerning his son who was born of the seed of David, according to the flesh, who was designated as the Son of God in power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. It further demonstrated the power of God over sin and death. In Ephesians 1, 19 through 20 we read, "And what is the surpassing greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of the might of his strength, which he worked in Christ by raising him from the dead and seating him at the right hand in heavenly places." Oh, beloved of the Lord, it guaranteed the believer's justification. Without the resurrection, there would be no heaven. We would not be justified. In Romans 4:25, Paul says, "He who was delivered over on account of our transgressions and was raised on account of our justification." Amen? It guarantees the believer's bodily resurrection as well. And here's the song that we sang earlier. In 1 Corinthians 15, 25, "For he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet." Beloved, it became the central doctrine of Christianity and the new and the unique message of faith as proclaimed by the early church. This Jesus, who God raised up, to which we are all witnesses. This is what we will look into this Lord's Day. Amen? I pray you're a little elevated, a little excited, huh? I'm excited. You see, nearly 2,000 years ago, Jesus was crucified on a bloody cross. He died, and 3 days later, he rose from the grave. He rose from the tomb. Amen? And beloved, he is not here, for he is risen. He has risen indeed. Amen? And praise God and hallelujah. Christ's work on the cross and his resurrection from the dead and his ascension into heaven opens the door for salvation for those he came to save. And now those who are saved have the indwelling Holy Spirit. Amen? Not only did he die so that we may have life, but he put his life in us, the life of the blessed Holy Spirit. What a Savior. And you know the Father and the Son sent the Holy Spirit. And that's the promise that we'll look into in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But we have Christ now in heaven who advocates for us before the Father. We have a great high priest who intercedes for us. All this comes out of the resurrection. You see, his saving work continues and will continue until he returns. Amen? Until he returns for each one of us, for his dear saints. It continues on the work that he has for us. Let's look at our first point. Our outline is in your bulletin if you'd like to follow along. The first point then, the resurrection. Now after the Sabbath, as it began to draw on toward the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave. We see this scripture tells us that there had been some time since the Sabbath had ended. As it began to dawn toward the first day of the week. The first day of the week is Sunday morning. In the Greek, it translates to day one after the Sabbath. That's exactly what it means. Day one after the Sabbath. The Friday before our Lord rose from the dead was the last divinely ordained Sabbath for his people. And as you know, at the resurrection, it ushered in the new covenant through Jesus Christ that Ryan taught about in Sunday school this morning. If this was not only a new day, but from that day forward, Christians worshiped Christ, the risen Lord, on Sunday rather than the Sabbath, and that's why it is now called the Lord's Day. Amen? Every day, as I understand that. But we do call Sunday the Lord's Day. The picture before the Sabbath was a day of resting. You'll remember that. Pointing back to creation in Genesis. When God rested after his creation. You remember that. It's good for us to be in the house of the Lord today. Because while we're here, we're not working 7 days a week. He said work 6 days a week. And rest in the finished work that Christ has done on the cross of Calvary today. Think about me. Think about Christ. Meditate upon Christ. Worship Christ this day. This is the day that God has given us to set aside, to be together as a family, but also to rest when we leave this place in the finished work that Christ has done. Now for the Christian, we celebrate the risen Lord and rest in his finished work on our behalf on the cross of Calvary. And Jesus said, "It is finished." We rest in that. We see this scripture in Acts 27, and it says, on the first day of the week, notice the words, and we were gathered together to break bread. Paul began speaking to them, intending to leave the next day, and he prolonged his message until midnight, and you probably remember what happened there. But 1 Corinthians also tells us, in 16:2, on the first day of every week, each one of you is to set something aside, saving whatever he has prospered, so that no collections be made when I come. We also see this in the book of Acts. They met on the Lord's Day. You remember the Lord met with the disciples a week later. We'll get into that a little later. But it is because of the resurrection of Christ that Christians worship our risen Lord on Sunday rather than on the Sabbath. Pretty simple, isn't it? Verse 1, now after the Sabbath, as it began to drawn toward the first day of the week, Jesus Christ rose after the Sabbath. And Jesus rose before dawn, and that is before the sun rose on Sunday morning. We heard that scripture earlier. And Jesus rose on the third day, which was the first day of the week. And Jesus had said in Matthew chapter 12, verse 40, where just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the sea monster, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. And you know that they use that also to bring charges against him. Matthew 16, 21, from that time Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed and be raised on the third day. He told us three times. He told the disciples three times. In Matthew 17, 23 as well, and they will kill him, and he will be raised on the third day, and they were deeply grieved. But like us, they don't listen to the Lord like we should. Or, like the disciples, we are of little faith as well sometimes. But beloved, his rising from the dead is a triumphant over death. It's over sin and death, over Satan. You see, death reigns no more. Its rule has been broken, and you can rejoice anytime. In Romans chapter 8, verse 2 through 4, we read, "For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and as an offering for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, so that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit." So far, I'm following Ryan's message this morning. But so true, isn't it? Now, after the Sabbath, as it began to draw toward the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave. And Mark tells us in Mark 16, 9 through 11, as we continue to look at the Synoptic Gospels here for more information as well. Now, after he had risen early on the first day of the week, he first appeared to Mary Magdalene, from whom he had cast out seven demons. She went and reported to those who had been with him. And while they were mourning and crying, and when they heard that he was alive and that he had been seen by her, they refused to believe. We understand that. They weren't looking for a resurrected Savior. In Luke chapter 24, 10 through 11, now Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the rest of the women with them were there, and they were telling these things to the apostles. Now listen to that. "But these words appeared to them as nonsense, and they were not believing them." So then Matthew tells us in our text, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave, and these are the first two witnesses to the resurrection. Mary came to look at the grave. Mark had told us they came to anoint him. And so we're learning more about the Gospels, from the Gospels. Beloved, between Matthew, Mark, and Luke, we learn there are at least five women at the tomb. Matthew said Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave. Mark adds, and Salome. Luke adds, Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and Mary, the mother of James, and the rest of the women. At least five that we know of. And they would have started out early on their journey to the tomb while it was still dark. So they arrived when it was early dawn, as the scripture says. Beloved, the women would have all believed that Jesus was still in the grave. They had been with the women who ministered to Jesus in Galilee, and they are the ones who were looking on to the cross. Remember, they were across the way looking on. And they were also there when Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus put Christ in the tomb. They were across as well. In Matthew chapter 27, verse 55 through 56, and many women were there looking on from a distance who had followed Jesus from Galilee while ministering to him. Among them was Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. So they all arrive at the tomb wondering who was going to remove the stone. And you heard that in the other gospel, so that they could minister to him one last time. That was their intention. I mean, you have to think about, what are they doing? Well, obviously the 100 pounds of spikenard and the things that Joseph wrapped the body of Christ, they felt they needed some more, that he needed more, and they wanted to finish it up. They loved the Lord. You know, think through it as you're hearing this text and ask questions. But they're wondering, who is going to move the stone? I mean, how are we going to be able to get in and minister to the Lord for one last time? And they were not thinking about the resurrection. It was their great love for their Lord. However, they are all in for a surprise, aren't they? And their faith will be tested and it will be enlarged. Let's look at our second point, the miraculous events. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled away the stone and sat upon it. And his appearance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards quaked from fear of him and became like dead men. Ha! All the very moment that the women arrived at the tomb, and behold, there was a great earthquake. This was a severe earthquake. And we had talked about this last time as well when we looked into the miracles accompanying his death. You'll remember there was great earthquakes when the darkness came, and then after he died, when he said, "It is finished." This is when God, here, I'd like to read to you in Exodus chapter 19, verse 18. Now Mount Sinai was all in smoke, because Yahweh descended upon it in fire, and its smoke ascended like the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain trembled violently. This is the same language in our text today. And this is when God had revealed his law to Moses in the presence of God. Beloved, everything shakes. It has to. Even creation groans. In 1 Kings 19:11, so he said, "Go forth and stand on the mountain before Yahweh, and behold, Yahweh was passing by." You remember this, and a great strong wind was tearing up the mountains and breaking it in pieces, the rocks before Yahweh. What a glorious God we serve. But Yahweh was not in the wind, and after the wind, an earthquake. But Yahweh was not in the earthquake. You'll remember, God revealed himself to Elijah in a small, still voice. Amen? But the earthquake was there as well. Earthquakes will always accompany the end times. In Joel chapter 2, verse 10, we read, "Before them the earth trembles, the heavens quake, the sun and the moon grow dark, and the stars lose their brightness." And as you know, this will be at the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, when he comes to judge his enemies. Revelation chapter 19. Beloved, as the angel of the Lord left heaven and entered earth, there was a great earthquake. For an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled away the stone and sat upon it. When the angel descended from heaven, the earth shook violently. Whew. And he sat upon it. It would have taken several men, if you remember from our study, it would have taken several men to be able to remove that stone. But just one angel moved that stone. C.H. Spurgeon helps us here. He says this. When he says, death was being upheaved and all the bars of the scripture were beginning to burst. When the king awoke from the sleep of death, he shook the world. The bedchamber in which he rested for a little while trembled at the earth, at the heavenly hero arose from his couch. Beloved, there was a great earthquake, nor was the king unattended in his rising, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven, and it was not merely one of the angels, angelic host, but some mighty in presence angel, the angel of the Lord, who came to minister to him on the resurrection morning. As Jesus was put in the prison of the tomb as a hostage for you and me, for his people. And that's what he says. Therefore, he must not break out by himself, but the angelic sheriff's office must bring the warrant for his deliverance and set the captivity at liberty. And when the angel had rolled back the stone from the door, he sat upon it as if to defy earth. I like this. Spurgeon just writes. He's so flowery. He says, he sat upon it as if to defy earth and hell ever to roll it back again. Amen? Listen, they could not keep our Lord in that tomb. There is absolutely no way, for he is not here. He has risen, and he has risen indeed. And he has risen in our hearts as well for all those who are in Christ Jesus. The angel of the Lord had manifested himself to those who were around the tomb. In verse 3, and his appearance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. Don't be so impressed with the angel. Like Moses, when his face shined after he had been with God, the angel who was sent from heaven had been in God's presence. And the angel's appearance, his clothing as white as snow, points to the Shekinah glory of God. You see, the angel had been in the holy presence of God. And like Moses, remember they were afraid to look upon Moses. They covered him with a veil. This angel leaves heaven and a great earthquake shines. He'd just been in the presence of the Lord for who knows how many thousands of years. And he is glowing with the holiness of God. One writer says the angel bore the very seal of approval of the character of God in order to make it clear to the observers not only that he was a supernatural messenger, but that he was an agent of God and not Satan. Now listen, they believed in all kinds of things back then. Oh, but this was an angel sent from the Lord. Our brother Calvin says it this way. He says here, the remnant and the countenance of the angel, too, might be said to be rays by which the splendor of the Godhead was diffused, so as to enable them to perceive that it was not a mortal man that stood near them, having the face of a man. For the dazzling light or the whiteness of snow is nothing in comparison of the boundless glory of God. But rather, if we wish to know him aright, we ought not to imagine to ourselves any color. Yet when he makes known by outward signs that he is present, he invites us to him as far as our weaknesses can endure. Don't make much of the angel. Don't make much of the whiteness. Don't make much of anything. It's the God that he serves. It's the Shekinah glory that is coming from the Father as he leaves heaven. We will see in our next verses two responses to this event. One was the guards and then the other the women. One receives comfort from the angel, the other flees out of fear. In verse 4, and the guards quaked from fear of him and became like dead men. You see, they were paralyzed with fear and could not move. That's what the text tells us. The Greek term that has the same root as earthquake in verse 4, and the guards quaked from fear of him and became like dead men. And they were taken with fear with what they saw, and they laid paralyzed on the ground. They couldn't even move, but yet they knew exactly what was taking place. See, these are hardened men. Think about these soldiers. They're hardened men who had probably seen war and all kinds of things. But here they are traumatized. And let's look at the words of comfort from the angel of the Lord to the women now in our next point. Point three, he is not here. And the angel answered and said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, just as he said. Come see the place where he was lying, and quickly go and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and behold, he is going ahead of you in Galilee, and there you will see him. Behold, I have told you." And they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to report to his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. And then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and report to my brothers to leave for Galilee, and there they will see me." Wow. And the angel answered and said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified." The angel declares, "Do not be afraid." Unlike the soldiers, the women received comfort. The angel answered their question, that is, "Where is Jesus?" And they had been looking to finish what Joseph and Nicodemus had started, as I mentioned earlier on Friday night. The angel of the Lord comforts them and says, "For I know that you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified." He tells them, "Do not be afraid." He tells the women that they have no reason to be fearful. Amen? Not so for the soldiers. It was not only fear because of the events of the angel and the earthquake, but also the tomb was empty, and they had been given charge to watch over it. And as you know, it was customary in that time, we could see that with the Philippian jailer as well, that if anyone escaped from prison or from the control of the soldiers, they were to be put to death. But the ladies arrived and heard from the angel of the Lord some of the sweetest words. Look at verse 6. "He is not here, for he has risen, just as he said. Come see the place where he was lying." Beloved, I want you to notice something in this verse, in these verses. You'll notice the angel's message contained four imperatives here. The first, then, and you've heard it a few times, come. The second, see. The third, go. And the fourth, and tell. Well, I want to tell you, that is the Great Commission right there. That's exactly what we'll be looking at next week. He says, come, see, go, and tell that he is risen. Jesus has been risen, and it was the work of the Trinity. Jesus had said earlier, and you're familiar with this verse, in John 10, 17 and 18, for this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life so that I might take it again. No one takes it from me, but from myself. I lay it down. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it again. This commandment have I received from my Father. And you remember at the cross, one of the signs was that Jesus decided when he was going to die. Yes, they were responsible for his death, but he still had power on when he would. Scripture also here tells us this commandment, he says, I received in my Father. And Scripture tells us also that it was by the power of his Father that he was resurrected. In Romans chapter 6, verse 4, therefore we were buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too might walk in the newness of life. And of the Holy Spirit as well in Romans chapter 8, verse 1. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Amen. How wonderful as you think through this. Through the Father, so too you might walk in the newness of life. Through the Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ. The Trinity was involved in the resurrection. And I know, don't try to figure it out. He never ceased to be God. Luke tells us in Luke chapter 24, verses 6 through 8, and he is not here, but he has risen. Remember how he spoke to you while he was still in Galilee, saying that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise again. And they remembered his words. Amen. So first the angel of the Lord told them to come see the place where he was laying in the tomb. And Mark tells us in Mark chapter 16, verse 6, and he said to them, do not be amazed. You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who has been crucified. He has risen. He is not here. Behold the place where they laid him. And Mark tells us the angel showed them as well as told them. He told them he had risen, and he said, come now and see. He showed them where the tomb was empty. Amen. Our dear sisters must have been out of their minds with joy. Think about these ladies that arrived at the tomb. John adds this in John 20:12, and she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and one at the feet, where the body of Jesus had been laying, and another angel, we're told, had joined the first angel. So the first angel comes from heaven, and there's an earthquake, and we see the second angel. And one is at the head, and one is at the feet, and that's a picture of the mercy seat. That's a picture of the cherubims, where God's mercy was displayed. There is so much here, we just don't have the time. The angel had said, just as he said in Luke 24, 5 through 7, and when the women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said, the two angels, why do you seek the living one amongst the dead? Oh, what a beautiful question. Just love that. He is not here, but he is risen. Remember how he spake to you while he was still in Galilee, saying that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and the third day rise again. Oh, beloved, what a time. How exciting. Think about this, if it was you arriving at the tomb and the fear that set in on Friday. But now on the Lord's Day, there's hope. So with that, the angel says in verse 7, we will hear the last two imperatives that I told you about in verse 7. And go quickly. Notice the word go and tell his disciples. Notice the word tell. That he has risen from the dead, and behold, he is going ahead of you in Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you. So much is made about the women being at the tomb and not the disciples. If you're reading any commentary at all, they make such a big deal out of that. And beloved, I want to tell you, don't make a big deal out of that. It's not worth making a big deal out of that. But many do, if you're reading. You see, it doesn't matter. If the disciples were there, they would have seen the same thing. But look at what Jesus says there. Go and tell them. I'm going to meet them in Galilee. So much then could be said about that, but no need. For now they are told to go and report the good news to the disciples. God used these faithful women, and God always uses faithful women. Amen. And he used these faithful women to go. We read in verse 8, and they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy, and they ran. Notice, to report it to his disciples. C.H. Spurgeon says here, Jesus always keeps his word. Amen? I like that. When I read that, I was like, absolutely. If he didn't keep it here, we're in a lot of trouble, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15. Then our faith would not be sight. Spurgeon says Jesus always kept his word. He is risen as he said. He said he would rise from the dead, and he did. He says that his people also shall rise, and they shall. Amen. Praise the Lord. Come see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly. The angel would not let the women stay long looking into the sepulcher, for there was work for them to do. You see that in the imperatives I gave you earlier. In this world, we cannot afford to spend all our time in contemplation, however heavenly it may be. Notice the angel's first words. He's going to repeat some of that. See, and then go. Make sure about the fact for yourselves, and then let others know of it. Think about the Great Commission. Think about telling others about the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, he has risen, but does anybody know it? What you know, tell and do it quickly. Swift be your feet. Such good news as you have to carry should not be long on the road. He says the king's business requires haste. Oh, I like that. And it's a commandment, by the way. They're told to go. And the women went, and they did what they were told to do, by the way. With fear and great joy, the scripture says, and ran to report it to the disciples. And I want to say here, this fear has now been tempered with joy because of the angel's announcement and the empty tomb. They realize that he is risen, and he has risen indeed. How precious that is. Verse 9, and behold, Jesus met them and said, greetings. And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. What a compassionate Savior. What a compassionate Savior. As they left the angel to go and report to the disciples, Jesus met them and said, greetings, shalom. And Jesus greets them with hello or good morning in our language. Just hello or good morning. Oh yeah, I just rose from the dead. You know, think about it. Think with me. This is how casual he was. Yep, that's what I told you. And he is just such a sweet and loving Savior. As he so tenderly speaks to these women. Jesus greets them with hello or good morning. And one writer says, in other words, the greeting was casual and ordinary, seemingly too mundane to appropriate for such a momentous occasion. Think about that. Yet the glorified Christ, who had just finished conquering sin and death, designed to greet those fearful women with an informal tenderness. And there's a lot here in the verse. You have to pass by that. I like what the writer of Hebrews says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in all things like we are, yet without sin. He is so compassionate. Beloved, thank him for that. Be thankful that the Father sees us through the blood of Christ. It's a question that young people ask when you're teaching. They say, how can God look at me as a sinner? And these are little third graders asking questions like that. It's because God, when you're saved, sees you through the imputed blood of Jesus Christ. God does not see you any longer. You belong to Christ. He was crucified. He suffered. And now you live. Amen. We live. Notice the words, as their faith now became sight. And immediately they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Their faith was without any doubt that he has risen indeed. They had heard the angel's words. They had seen the empty tomb. And now they have heard the risen Lord. They actually have touched the risen Lord. And they worshiped him. And Jesus repeats the angel's message to them in verse 10. Look at verse 10. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and report to my brothers to leave for Galilee, and there they will see me." Oh, the women are full of joy. I mean, how can you not be? It's like the day that God saved you. Full of joy. As we saw the holiness of God and the sinfulness of our hearts. Full of joy. And you think about that. Don't be afraid. Go and report it. Beloveds, look at the beloved, look at the text. The women are full of joy, and he says, "Go and tell my brothers, I will meet them in Galilee." And here we see the first time after the resurrection of Christ that he calls his disciples his brothers. What a tender moment this is, and how beautiful it is. Let us not pass over that. He calls them his brethren. And we have heard one group rushing into the city with joy, the second group in fear. Let's look at our last point, point four. This is the attempt to discredit the resurrection. In verses 11 through 15, "Now while they were on their way, behold, some of the guard came into the city and reported to the chief priest all that had happened. And when they had assembled with the elders and took counsel together, they gave a large sum of money to the soldiers and said, 'You are to say his disciples came by night and stole him away while we were asleep.'" Wow, what a story. "And if this is heard before the governor, we will win him over and keep you out of trouble." Wow. "And they took the money and did as they had been instructed. And this story was widely spread among the Jews and is to this day." I want you to notice some of them went into the city. Do you notice that in the verse? Just some of the soldiers? Remember, there was quite an amount of soldiers at the tomb. But just some of them went in. For if they would have all gone in, it would have stirred up curiosity and created a problem for the religious leaders. If you see a rush of guards rushing into the city to go meet with the Sanhedrin, which is really strange on its own. So just a few of them, you see that in the scripture. So they reported to the chief priest all that had happened. What they did was they brought a report to the Sanhedrin about the event of the resurrection. What they did was tell them the truth. And within hours, the Sanhedrin realized that within hours that the truth was going to go around the whole place. They didn't need internet or newspapers. They had the tongue. And so within hours, it would be all around the town, and they had to come up with a devious plan. And their plan is so foolish that I'm not even an attorney, and I could notice they took counsel together. You will hear how they put into play a three-point resolution. Look at that. That's exactly what they did. "Bribe them with a large sum of money." Oh, that works for most men. "What's your price?" We don't have a price, amen? We've been bought and paid for. But notice the three things. Bribe them with a large sum of money. What are they going to do? Spread the lie. That makes sense. The Sanhedrin then would protect them. So the women who went to the tomb on Resurrection Sunday were not only the ones to know about it, they weren't the only ones to know about it, but the Roman guards were present when the angel of the Lord rolled away the stone, and they were terrified by it, remember? So they're going to go and tell the story, the true story. And they had reported how the angels had come and opened the tomb. However, he was not there. And now that's their problem. The religious authorities were besides themselves. I mean, they are just... They had said earlier, you'll remember, to Pilate in Matthew chapter 27, verse 41 and 42, You'll remember their story in the same way the chief priest also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him and saying, he saved others, he cannot save himself. He is the king of Israel. Let him now come down from the cross and we will believe in him. And let me tell you, they won't believe in him. And there are many people that we're witnessing to as well. They won't believe in him. They won't believe this resurrection story nearly 2,000 years ago. They will not. Unless the God of heaven opens their hearts and minds and gives within them a new heart so that they can love him and they could know him and they could obey him, no man has any chance to come to God on his own. Every single person that has ever been born has a sin nature. And that sin has separated them from a holy God. And they need a Savior, and Jesus Christ is that Savior. And they will not believe him. And they do the only thing that they can do, and that was to take counsel together. You see it in the scripture. They're taking counsel together. That should seem very strange to your mind. Taking counsel? Roman guards taking counsel with supposing religious leaders? It should really rock our world. The truth would have to be hidden and a new story must be told. The answer is to bribe them with a large sum of money and promise protection against Pilate. What a great plan. The Roman soldiers feared Pilate much more than their Jewish leaders. And we are not told how much money was given to them, just that they gave a large sum of money to the soldiers. Our word money here points us to an important thing that we should know about this text. The money that was given was actually silver. And this is the same word used in Matthew 26, verse 15. And said, what are you willing to give me to deliver him to you? You remember with Judas. And they weighed out 30 pieces of silver to him. The Sanhedrin would pay anything for their help. They're willing to pay anything. But they must say what they have been told in verse 13. And said, you are to say, his disciples came by night and stole him away while we were asleep. What a brilliant plan, huh? You see, however, both the soldiers and the Sanhedrin knew the truth. This is going to really go through the book of Acts. We'll be starting the book of Acts in 2 weeks. And we're going to see a lot of this still happening. One writer says that they were pagan, materialistic, self-indulgent, and hardened to every sort of evil. I like that. That's who these soldiers are. And this was trivial and insignificant. It was an insignificant lie. It was a small piece to gain the Sanhedrin's favor and protection. Wow. How much is your character worth? You think about it. Now in verse 14, and if this is heard before the governor, we will win him over and keep you out of trouble. So that's their plan. That's not so good, is it? Bribe the soldiers, tell a lie, and if this is heard before the governor, we will win Pilate over and keep you out of trouble. I just can't see it, but I'm a simple preacher. I just can't see how this would even work. This lie was not even a good plan, and if they were all sleeping, think with me now, if they were all sleeping while they should have been watching over the tomb, they are guilty of death. If that's their plan, that they're going to say, we were all sleeping, it's supposed to be that you have two-hour shifts. The soldiers were to sleep for 2 hours, and then a new group of soldiers were to come in. They're all saying, we were all sleeping. They've broken every one of the laws. I mean, this is just pure foolishness, but that's how Satan drives some men. And you think about this. You got to ask questions of this text. How was it that they didn't awake when many men would have had to move the tomb, had to move the stone away from the tomb? I mean, they're right in front of it. I've been here. If they're right in front of it, there is absolutely no way that you're going to move that rock with all those men that it's going to take to move it, and you're going to do that in silence and not awake these soldiers? No, no, no. This is not going to happen. And why was there not a search for the body of Jesus that had been stolen? Well, why didn't they go out and search for the body? If they were sleeping, let's just say they were tired, why didn't they go search for the body? That was their responsibility. That would be one of the first things that they were responsible to do, was to go and search. And you see, grave robbing was a huge problem at this time. And grave robbing also brought with it death. They were responsible to go and to search for the body of Jesus Christ. Where's the body of Christ? Where did the body go? Who took the body? Verse 15, and they took the money and did as they had been instructed. And this story was widely spread among the Jews as it is to this day. You see, although they worked for Rome, they took their orders from the Sanhedrin. Unimaginable as well. And this story was widely spread among the Jews and to this day. That text, and to this day, it refers to the time that Matthew writes his gospel. Matthew wrote the gospel in 63 AD. So nearly 30 years later, they're still saying the same story. And if you repeat it long enough, man believes it, don't they? On the other hand, the women were fearful. In Luke 24, 9 through 12, we read, and when they returned from the tomb, they reported all the things to the 11 and to all the rest. Now Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary the mother of James and the rest of the women with them were there. And they were telling these things to the apostles. But these words appeared to them as nonsense, and they were not believing them. But Peter stood up and ran to the tomb, stooping to look in. He saw the linen wrappings only, and he went away by himself, marveling at what had happened. The testimony of the resurrection and our Lord's enemies gave all the evidence anyone would need to believe. I didn't even touch the text, and we could ask questions about the text and prove that it was a lie. We invite you, though, today to come and see, for he is not here, he is risen. If you have not come to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, there is room for you at the cross. It is level ground at the cross. Everyone has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and there is room for you at the cross. Jesus said, come to me, and I will give you rest. There is room for you. If you would repent and you would turn to Christ and bow before him today as the women did in our story today, you bow at his feet and worship him as Lord and Savior. You'd be like Thomas 8 days after the resurrection. And Christ said to him, stick your fingers in the nail prints of my hands. Stick them in my side. Stick them in my feet. And don't be not believing. Have faith. And Thomas looked at Christ and said, my Lord and my God. There is room for you at the cross. Jesus paid it all. Will you believe that he is the Son of the living God and God the Son, and that he has resurrected as he promised he would? Or will you continue not to believe and to tell the old, old story? And one day, you will have to stand before the judge of this universe and you will have to give an answer. What will your answer be? Father, we are thankful for this beautiful scripture that you have given to us to study and to teach and to enjoy as well. Even though it's difficult, it's bittersweet. We learn so much. Father, I just love the way you give us scripture. You give us everything. You leave nothing out, even the disciples doubting. You put that in there for us. Father, we know your scripture is true. It is inerrant. It is infallible. And we fully trust it. Lord Jesus, we want to thank you for coming and dying so that we may have life. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for coming. Thank you for taking our sin upon you who knew no sin so that we might be called the children of God, that your righteousness would now, your imputed righteousness would be put upon us. We would be justified. And Father, we're so thankful for the work that you're doing. We also look forward to the day of our glorification. But Father, be with us now as we continue to worship you in truth and spirit. Receive our worship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, let's stand. Christ the Lord is risen today. Woo! Amen.
The Lord is risen today, alleluia. Earth and heaven in chorus say, alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high, alleluia. Sing ye heavens and earth's reply, alleluia. It's again our glorious King, alleluia. Where, O death, is now thy sting, alleluia. Once he died our souls to save, alleluia. Where's thy victory most great, alleluia. Redeeming work is done, alleluia. Fought the fight, the battle won, alleluia. Death in vain forbids him rise, alleluia. Christ has opened paradise, alleluia. So we now where Christ has led, alleluia. Falling our exalted head, alleluia. Made like him we rise, alleluia. Ours the cross, the grave, the sky, alleluia.
Amen. Praise.
Amen, indeed. Our benediction this week is Psalms 121, and I pray that you can say this about yourself along with us, and if not, be sure to talk to someone in our audience. We'll talk to you or point you to somebody who can. I will lift up my eyes to the mountains. From where shall my help come from? My help comes from Yahweh, who made heaven and earth. He shall not allow your foot to stumble. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will not slumber, will not sleep. Yahweh is your keeper. Yahweh is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. Yahweh will keep you from all evil. He will keep your soul. Yahweh will keep your going out and your coming in from now until forever. God bless you. Make it a great week.